Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. Dear brothers and sisters, Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Inshallah, we will bring today's program with a recitation of the Quran by Brother Farik Zakir Naik.
أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم يا أيها الذين آمنوا إن تطيعوا فريقا من الذين أوتوا الكتاب يردوكم بعد إيمانكم كافرين وكيف تكفرون وأنتم تتلى عليكم آيات الله وفيكم رسوله ومن يعتصم بالله فقد هدي إلى صراط مستقيم يا أيها الذين آمنوا اتقوا الله حق تقاته ولا تموتن إلا وأنتم مسلمون واعتصموا بحبل الله جميعا ولا تفرقوا واذكروا نعمة الله عليكم إذ كنتم أعداء فألف بين قلوبكم فأصبحتم بنعمته إخوانا وكنتم على شفا حفرة من النار فأنقذكم منها كذلك يبين الله لكم آياته لعلكم تهتدون ولتكن منكم أمة يدعون إلى الخير ويأمرون بالمعروف وينهون عن المنكر وأولئك هم المفلحون صدق الله العظيم.
The translation of the verses that Brother Farik just recited, which are from Surah Al-Imran, chapter 3, verses 102 to 104. O you who believed, fear Allah as He should be feared, and do not die except as Muslims in submission to Him. And hold firmly to the rope of Allah altogether, and do not become divided. And remember the favor of Allah upon you when you were enemies and He brought your hearts together. And you became by His favor brothers, and you were on the edge of a pit of the fire, and He saved you from it. Thus does Allah make clear to you His verses, that you may be guided. And let there be arising from you a nation, inviting to all that is good, enjoining all that is right, and forbidding what is wrong, and those will be the successful. Now, I would like to invite Brother Arif Julfar, the member of organizing committee, head of the program of activities unit, Dubai Holy Quran Award, organizers of tonight's program, to kindly come on stage and address the audience.
Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullah. First thing, Ramadan Mubarak to all of you. Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. Alhamdulillahi Rabbil Alameen. Wa salatu wa salamu ala Sayyidina Muhammad wa ala alihi wa sahbihi ajma'in. We thank Almighty Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for achieving the month of Ramadan. And we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to lead us to His best way and accept our good deeds. Tonight, we are receiving one of the most glorious speakers in the world, Dr. Zakir Naik. Dr. Zakir, mashallah, has been doing da'wah work. He left his area of specialties, which was medicine doctor, for the work of da'wah in the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Dubai International Holy Quran Award was insisting to receive Dr. Zakir in this session, which is number 13. And alhamdulillah, we received him a couple times during the previous years. Dr. Zakir, mashallah, he knows not only Islam, but also knows very well all about the other religions. So he can talk what are mainly the similarities in the beginning between Islam, which is his religion, and other religions, Hinduism, Christianism, Judaism, and so on. So this is one of the things that made our organizing committee in Dubai International Holy Quran Award to invite Dr. Zakir to deliver his speech today and tomorrow in the same place, inshallah ta'ala. I really thank, first thing, Dr. Zakir for being here tonight. We really thank his team. I don't want to mention some of their names, so I will not forget others, for working day and night to getting this place and this event be ready for this moment. But just I will ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to reward them the best. Finally, I thank all of you for being here tonight, and we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to give mercy to all of you and to all of those who are watching. Wassalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi ta'ala wa barakatuh.
Before I call upon you, Dr. Zakir Naik, I would like to give his brief introduction. Dr. Zakir Naik, a medical doctor by professional training, is renowned as a dynamic international orator on Islam and comparative religion. Dr. Zakir Naik is the president of Islamic Research Foundation, Mumbai. Dr. Zakir Naik clarifies Islamic viewpoints and clears misconceptions about Islam using the Quran, authentic hadith, and other religious scriptures as a basis in conjunction with reason, logic, and scientific facts. He is 43 years old. He is popular for his critical analysis and convincing answers to challenging questions posed by audiences after his public talks. In the last 12 years, by the year 2008, Dr. Zakir Naik has delivered more than 1,200 public talks in the USA, Canada, UK, Italy, Saudi Arabia, UAE, Kuwait, Qatar, Bahrain, Oman, Australia, New Zealand, South Africa, Botswana, Malaysia, Hong Kong, Thailand, Guyana, South America, Trinidad, and many other countries, in addition to numerous public talks in India. He has successfully participated in several symposia and dialogues with prominent personalities of other faiths. His public dialogue with Dr. William Campbell of the USA on the topic, The Quran and the Bible in the Light of Science, held in Chicago, USA on April 2000, was a resounding success. His interfaith dialogue with prominent Hindu guru Sri Sri Ravi Shankar on the topic, The Concept of God in Hinduism and Islam in the Light of the Sacred Scriptures, held at Palace Grounds, Bangalore, on 21st Jan 2006, was highly appreciated by people of both the faiths. In the issue dated 22nd Feb 2009 of the Indian Express, list of the 100 most powerful Indians in 2009, amongst the billion plus population of India, Dr. Zakir Naik was ranked number 82 in the special list of the top 10 spiritual gurus of India. Dr. Zakir Naik was ranked number 3 after Baba Ramdev and Sri Sri Ravi Shankar, being the only Muslim in the list. Dr. Zakir Naik stood out most eloquently for Islam and Muslims in the present times on one of the leading and most respected news channels of India, NDTV 24/7, during the Guest This Week interview program Walk the Talk, conducted by host Shikhar Gupta, editor-in-chief of Indian Express, telecast on 7th and 8th March 2009. Sheikh Ahmed Didat, the world-famous orator on Islam and comparative religion, who called Dr. Zakir Didat Plus in 1994, presented a plaque in May 2000 with the engraving awarded to Dr. Zakir Abdul Karim Naik for his achievement in the field of Dawah and the study of comparative religion. Son, what you have done in 4 years had taken me 40 years to accomplish, alhamdulillah. Dr. Zakir Naik appears regularly on many international TV channels in more than 200 countries of the world. He is regularly invited for TV and radio interviews. More than 100 of his talks, dialogues, debates and symposia are available on DVDs and VCDs. He has authored many books on Islam and comparative religion. Brothers and sisters, please welcome Dr. Zakir Naik.
Alhamdulillah. Wassalatu wassalam. Ala Rasulillah wa ala ali wa sahbihi ajmain. Amma ba'd. A'udhu billahi minash shaitani rajim. Bismillahir Rahmanir Rahim. Kuntum khayra ummatin ukhrijat lin nas. Ta'muruna bil ma'ruf wa tanhauna 'anil munkar wa tu'minuna billah. Kul in kana aba'ukum wa abna'ukum wa ikhwanukum wa azwajukum wa ashiratukum wa amwalun iqtaraftumuha wa tidarusun takshawna qasadaha ومساكن ترضونها أحب إليكم من الله ورسوله وجهاد في سبيله فتربصوا حتى يأتي الله بأمري والله لا يذلكم الفاسقين رب اشرح لي صدري ويسر لي أمري واحلل عقدة من لساني يفقهوا قولي My respected elders and my dear brothers and sisters, I welcome all of you with the Islamic greetings. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. May peace, mercy and blessings of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, of Almighty God, be on all of you. It's an honor for me to be invited for the third time by the Dubai International Holy Quran Award, organized by the Dubai government under the patronage of Sheikh Mohammed Rashid Al Maktoum, the Vice President and Prime Minister of UAE and the ruler of Dubai. And it's a pleasure for me to address the audience of Dubai after a gap of 4 years. And I remember the last I'd addressed the audience of Dubai was in 2005, Ramadan, again organized by the Dubai International Holy Quran Award. And it was just before we launched our satellite channel, that's the Peace TV, just about 2 months before we launched our satellite channel. And alhamdulillah, by Allah's grace, the Peace TV in the span of 3.5 years has become the most popular and the most watched Islamic satellite channel in the world. Not only has it become the most watched Islamic channel, but in the last few months, it has become the most popular watched religious channel in the world. Alhamdulillah. And today, the estimated viewership of Peace TV is, alhamdulillah, more than 100 million people throughout the world. And you'll be happy to know, 2 months ago, we launched a second channel. Previously in the Peace TV, we had 75% English and 25% Urdu. The people who didn't know English used to complain that why is Urdu so less? And in the Western world, those who didn't understand Urdu, Hindi used to say, what is this in between Urdu and Hindi programs coming? So to satisfy both the people, 2 months back, we launched a second satellite channel, which is called as the Peace TV Urdu. So I think that whenever the Dubai International Holy Quran Award calls me, I think it's linked with the launch of a satellite channel. And you'll be happy to know that both these channels are, alhamdulillah, uplinked from the Dubai Media City. The uplink from Dubai Media City is on the Inter side and Arab side, covering Asia, Middle East, Africa, Australia. And from London, we uplink and cover Europe and North and South America. So I would like to thank the Dubai Holy Quran Award for calling me, and for even Dubai government for giving the facility for uplinking both these satellite channels. The topic of this evening's talk is Dawah or Destruction. What is the meaning of the word Dawah? Those of us, especially people coming from the Indian subcontinent who speak Hindi and Urdu, they know the meaning of the word Dawat. And the moment we hear the word Dawat, we start thinking of chicken biryani or mutton biryani. You know, as though we're having a party. Dawah or Dawat actually means an invitation. Dawah means to call. Today, we will not be speaking about an invitation to a lunch or a dinner party. Today we'll be speaking about Da'wat al-Islam, an invitation, a call to Islam. And an invitation is not given to the own family members. Normally, an invitation is given to an outsider. Similarly, Da'wat al-Islam is mainly an invitation, a call to the non-Muslims. Whenever we speak about Islam to a non-Muslim, trying to clarify the misconception, trying to make him understand Islam better, to remove the negative idea that he has about Islam, it is called as Dawah. Many a time, Dawah is also used synonymously when we speak about Islam to a Muslim. But the more appropriate Arabic word, when we speak about Islam to a Muslim, it is Islah. Islah in Arabic means to repair. It means to improve. So when a Muslim speaks to another Muslim, giving him more information about Islam, the more appropriate word is Islah. And when we speak to the non-Muslims, talking about Islam, the more appropriate word is Dawah. So today, we'll be discussing Dawah or destruction. The Muslims should convey the message of Islam and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to the non-Muslims, otherwise they will be destroyed. I started my talk by quoting a verse from the glorious Quran, from Surah Al Imran, chapter number 3, verse number 110, where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, Kuntum khaira ummatin ukhrijat linnas. O ye people, O ye Muslims, ye are the best of peoples evolved for mankind. Ye Muslims are the best of peoples evolved for mankind. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is calling us Muslims as the khaira ummah. Allah is giving us that honor. Whenever an honor is given, it is always followed up with a responsibility. There is no honor without responsibility. For example, in a school, the principal has got more honor than a teacher. A teacher has got more honor than a clerk. Similarly, the principal has got more responsibility than a teacher. A teacher has got more responsibility than a clerk. There is no honor without responsibility. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in the glorious Quran is calling us Muslim as a khaira ummah. He's calling us as the best of people. Don't you think we have a responsibility? The reply is given in the same verse. Allah continues and says, تَأْمُرُونَ بِالْمَعْرُوفِ وَتَنْهَوْنَ عَنِ الْمُنْكَرِ وَتُؤْمِنُونَ بِاللَّهِ. Because you enjoin what is good and you forbid what is wrong and you believe in Allah. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is calling us Muslim as a khaira ummah because we enjoin what is good and we forbid what is wrong and we believe in Allah. If we do not enjoin what is good and if we do not forbid what is wrong, we aren't fit to be called as khaira ummah. We aren't fit to be called as Muslims. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gives us this honor, calls us Muslims the khaira ummah, the best of people, because we enjoin what is good and we forbid what is wrong and we believe in Allah. If we do not convey the message of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to the non-Muslims and remove the misconceptions that is there in their minds, we aren't fit to be called as khaira ummah. We aren't fit to be called as Muslims. Allah says in the Quran, in Surah Baqarah, chapter number 2, verse number 143, that we have made you an ummate wast, a middlemost community, a justly balanced community, so that you may be a witness over the nations and the messenger will be a witness over you. Allah has made us Muslims as an ummate wast, a middlemost community, a justly balanced community, so that we convey the message, we bear witness to the others, to the other people in humanity, and our messenger Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam will bear witness over us. In the beginning of my speech, I also quoted a verse of the Quran from Surah Tawbah, chapter number 9, verse number 24. Surah Tawbah happens to be the most militant surah in the glorious Quran. If you read the Quran, the most militant surah in the complete Quran is Surah Tawbah. Why do I say that Surah Tawbah is the most militant surah in the Quran? Because Surah Tawbah is the only surah in the glorious Quran which does not begin with the beautiful formula Bismillahir Rahmanir Rahim. In the name of Allah, most gracious, most merciful. Every surah, every chapter of the glorious Quran begins with the beautiful formula Bismillahir Rahmanir Rahim. In the name of Allah, most gracious, most merciful. Except Surah Tawbah, chapter number 9. If you read Surah Ikhlas, chapter number 112. Bismillahir Rahmanir Rahim. Qul huwa Allahu ahad. In the name of Allah, most gracious, most merciful. Say is Allah one and only. Surah Falaq, chapter number 113. Bismillahir Rahmanir Rahim. Qul a'udhu bi rabbil falaq. Say, I seek refuge with the Lord of Dawn. Surah Nas, chapter number 114. Bismillahir Rahmanir Rahim. Qul a'udhu bi rabbin nas. In the name of Allah, most gracious, most merciful. Say, I seek refuge with Allah, who is the Lord of the humankind. Every chapter begins with the beautiful formula, Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. In the name of Allah, most gracious, most merciful. But in the beginning of Surah Tawbah, chapter number 9, there is no Bismillah. Why? For example, if you are walking down the streets of Dubai, maybe on Dubai Corniche, along with your wife, or along with your mother, and suppose there is a hooligan who snatches the handbag of your wife or of your mother and he runs away, what will you do? But naturally follow. And the moment you catch up with him, you will not say, Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullah, may peace be on you. You will not say, Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim, in the name of Allah, most gracious, most merciful. The moment you catch up with him, you will get down to the subject directly. Hey mister, give the handbag, I'll break your neck. Hey mister, give the handbag, I'll break your arm. You will get down to the subject directly. Bismillah is uncalled for. Similarly, if you read Surah Tawbah, chapter number 9, if you read the few verses in the beginning, there was a peace treaty between the Muslims and the Mushriks of Makkah. And this peace treaty was unilaterally broken by the Mushriks of Makkah. By the time Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala reaches verse number 5, Surah Tawbah chapter number 9, He is giving a warning. He is giving an ultimatum to the Mushriks of Makkah. You put things straight in 4 months' time, otherwise there is a declaration of war. When Allah is giving an ultimatum, is giving a warning, He gets down to the subject directly. Though there are many reasons why Bismillah is not there in Surah Tawbah, but some of the Mufassireen, they say that because Allah is giving a warning directly to the Mushriks of Makkah, Bismillah is uncalled for. He gets down to the subject directly. But by the time Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala reaches verse number 24, now He is addressing us Muslims. Now we Muslims are in the firing line. And Allah says, Kul, say, In kana abaukum, whether it be for your fathers, wa abnaukum, or your sons, wa ikhwanukum, or your brothers, wa azwajukum, or your spouses, your wives or husbands, wa ashiratukum, or your relatives. Allah is asking, what are your considerations? Are they your fathers? Are they your sons? Are they your spouses, your wives or husbands? Are they your relatives? And Allah continues, wa amwalun ikhtaraftumuha wa tidaratum taksawna qasadaha wa masakinu tarzawnaha. The wealth that you have amassed, the business in which you deal, the houses in which you live. Allah is asking, what are your considerations? Are they your fathers? Are they your sons? Are they your brothers? Are they your spouses? Are they your relatives? The wealth you have amassed, the business in which you deal, the houses in which you live. Some people may be worried that, you know, what will my father say? What will my son say? What will my brother say? My spouses or my relatives? There'll be a loss in my business. Maybe the wealth I've amassed, I will lose it. The house that I live in, there may be danger to it. And Allah continues, Ahabba ilaykum minallahi wa rasulihi wa jihadin fi sabilihi. If you love all these things more than Allah, His Rasul, and doing jihad in the way of Allah. Allah says, if you love all these 8 things, your fathers, your sons, your brothers, your spouses, your wives and husbands, your relatives, the business in which you deal, the wealth that you have amassed, the house in which you live, if you love all these 8 things more than Allah, His Messenger, His Rasul, and doing jihad in the way of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allah says, Fatarabbasu, wait. Hatta yati Allahu bi amri, until Allah brings about His decision unto you. Hatta yati Allahu bi amri, until Allah brings about His destruction unto you. Wallahu la yazlikum al-fasiqin, and Allah guides not the fasiq people. Allah is telling in this verse of the Quran of Surah Tawbah, chapter 9, verse number 24, that if you love your father, your sons, your brothers, your spouses, your relatives, the wealth you have amassed, the business in which you deal, the houses in which you live, if you love all these 8 things more than Allah, more than His Rasul, His Messenger, and doing jihad in the way of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And jihad fi sabilillah is of various types. And today, the best jihad, according to me, is conveying the message of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. It is dawah. Conveying the message of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to the non-Muslims. Removing the misconception from their minds. If you love all these 8 things more than Allah, His Rasul, and doing jihad in the way of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, Allah says, wait. What does Allah mean when He says, wait? And we Muslims are waiting, sitting on our backside doing nothing. What does Allah mean when He says, wait? For example, if in a school, there is a senior student who's bullying the junior student. And the junior student tells the senior student, wait till I get my elder brother. And his elder brother happens to be the biggest hooligan in that area. When the junior student is telling the senior student, wait, what he's actually telling him is that you buzz off. You vanish. You better improve. Otherwise, you'll be taught a lesson. So similarly, Allah says, Fatarabbus, wait. He's telling us Muslims, wait. Wait doesn't mean, and we Muslims are waiting, sitting on our backside doing nothing. What does Allah mean when He says, wait? He's telling you buzz off. You better improve. فَتَرَبَّصُوا حَتَّى يَعْتِيَ اللَّهُ الْيَمْرِ وَاللَّهُ لَعَزُمُ الْفَاسِقِينَ. Wait until Allah brings His destruction unto you. And Allah guides not the fasik people. Imagine Allah is comparing these 8 things with the love of Allah, His Rasul, and doing jihad in His way. The first He says is whether it be for your fathers. And you know that in the Quran, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, after believing in Allah, the next thing Allah says is you have to be kind to your parents. Allah says in Surah Isra, chapter number 17, verse number 23 and 24, that He has ordained for you that you worship none but Him. And that you be kind to your parents. And if one or both of them reach old age, don't say a word of contempt. Don't say oof to them. Rather, address them with honor and speak with them with respect and lower to them your wing of humility and pray to the Lord that cherish them, bless them as they cherished me in childhood. Now Allah is comparing your parents, whether it be for parents, in terms of love of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Your parents, your sons, your spouses, your relatives, your brothers. And then He says, the wealth you have amassed, the business in which you deal, the house in which you live. That means the wealth that you have amassed, if you do not spend in the way of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, then Allah says, wait, fatarabbas. And Allah gives an example, a beautiful example in Surah Baqarah, chapter number 2, verse number 261. Allah says that if you spend your wealth in the way of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, it is like a grain of corn which grows into 7 ears, each year bearing 100 grains. That means Allah says, if you sow one grain of corn in the way of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, Allah will give you 7 spikes, 7 ears, each bearing 100 grains. That means if you give one, Allah will give you 700 times. In business terminology, it is called as 70,000%. And I'm talking about business because I know that the world is hit with recession, and especially Dubai. So if you want a business in which you will never lose, it is business with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. You know, in these times of turmoil, ups and downs, markets go up, markets come down, the business in which you'll never lose is business with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allah promises you 700 times return, 70,000% return. 70,000. The market in Dubai was good. In 1 year, you're getting 50% profit, 100% profit, real estate, 200% profit. Everyone goes into it. When Allah is telling 70,000% profit, no one is going for Allah's way. Why? We say we believe in Allah. 70,000% Allah promise. And Allah doesn't stop there. He continues. And Allah will give you many fold more. So Allah is comparing all these 8 things which you love. Your fathers, your sons, your brothers, your husbands and wives, your relatives, the wealth you have amassed, the business in which you deal, the house in which you live. Allah is saying, if you love all these things more than Allah, His Rasul, and doing jihad in the way of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, Allah says, فَتَرَبَّصُ wait, hatta يَأْتِي اللَّهُ بِأَمْرِي, until Allah brings about His destruction to you. وَاللَّهُ يَلَذُكُمْ الْفَاسِقِينَ, and Allah guides not the fasiq people. Allah says in Surah Muhammad, chapter number 47, verse number 38, وَإِن تَتَوَلَّوْا يَسْتَبْدِلْ قَوْمًا غَيْرَكُمْ ثُمَّ لَا يَكُنْ أَمْثَالَكُمْ. If you do not do your job, if you turn away from Allah's path, Allah will substitute in your place another people. ثُمَّ لَا يَكُنْ أَمْثَالَكُمْ, and they will not be like you. Allah tells in the Quran in Surah Muhammad, chapter number 47, verse number 38, وَإِن تَتَوَلَّوْا, if you do not do your job, if you turn away from Allah's path, يَسْتَبْدِلْ قَوْمًا غَيْرَكُمْ, Allah will substitute in your place another people, ثُمَّ لَا يَكُنْ أَمْثَالَكُمْ, and they will not be like you. And this example we see that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala first chose the Jews to deliver His message. They were the chosen people of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, but they were very proud. They did not follow Allah's commandments. If you read the Quran, more than 75% of the messengers of the prophets mentioned in the Quran, they are Jews. Majority. The Jews, they were the chosen people of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, but they did not follow Allah's commandments. Allah gives the example in Surah Jummah, chapter number 62, verse number 5, that the message of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the Mosaic law, was given to the Jews. But they did not do the obligations. The example, the similitude is that like donkeys, on whose back is tomes, tons of books, and they understand it not. The Jews were the chosen people, but they did not follow the commandment of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. They did not follow the message. So Allah gives the similitude that they are like donkeys on whose backs is tomes, tons of books, and they understand it not. And the same message is given in the Bible. If you read the Bible in the Gospel of Matthew, chapter number 21, verse number 43, it says that the kingdom of God will be taken away from you and given to those nations who shall bear fruit of it. That means if you do not follow Allah's commandments, if you do not follow the commandment of God, in Gospel of Matthew chapter 21 verse 43, it says that the kingdom of God will be taken away from you and given to the nation who shall bear fruit thereof. And we have these examples. The Jews, they were proud. They said, we are the chosen people. And Allah has His own way. If you do not follow Allah's commandments, what He does, the people He looked down upon, He brings them from the dirt and makes them to sit on your head. And the Jews, they looked down upon the Arabs. 14 years back, the Arabs were looked down upon the Jews. And those days, it was called as Jamil Jahiliya, the days of the ignorance. The Arabs were the ignorant people that time. And they were so ignorant that they did the tawaf around the Kaaba naked. They had a philosophy, how can we present ourselves to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala better than the way we came in this world? So they did the tawaf around the Kaaba naked. They were that ignorant. What does Allah do? If you do not follow His commandment, وَإِن تَتَوَلَّوْا يَسْتَبْدُلْ قَوْمًا غَيْرَكُمْ, Allah will substitute a place another people, ثُمَّ لَا يَكُنْ أَمْثَالَكُمْ, and they will not be like you. So Allah brings these Arabs, and through the revelation of the glorious Quran, He makes these Arabs, who were called the most ignorant people, as the torch bearers of the world. He makes the people you look down upon to sit on your head. And we find that after the revelation of the Quran, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala makes the Arabs as the most enlightened people. But we should not be proud like the Jews. If we start being proud like the Jews, Allah says, يَسْتَبْدُلْ قَوْمًا غَيْرَكُمْ ثُمَّ لَا يَكُنْ أَمْثَالَكُمْ, if you do not do your job, if you do not follow the commandment, Allah will substitute in your place another people, ثُمَّ لَا يَكُنْ أَمْثَالَكُمْ, and they will not be like you. And we have the example in Spain. We Muslims, we ruled Spain for about 800 years, but we did not convey the message. We did not give dawah. What does Allah do? Allah wipes out the Muslims. There was not a single Muslim who could openly give the azan in Spain. The Crusaders came and they wiped out the Muslims. We did not do the job. We didn't convey a message. So now Allah is giving us a warning. And we see the ups and downs in history, that if we do not do the job, if we do not convey the message of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, when Allah is giving us hidayah to the non-Muslims, Allah will substitute in your place another people, summa lakin amsalukum, and they will not be like you. MashaAllah. Whenever you ask this question, and I like to ask this question to the Muslims here, that who do you love the most in this world? Who do you love the most in this world? Allah, MashaAllah. 100% correct. There is no price for that. Simple question, simple answer. When you ask any Muslim, who do you love the most? His answer would be Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. You ask any Muslim from any part of the world, who do you love the most? His answer would be Allah. Do we love Allah more than our mother? Yes or no? Yes or no? Yes, MashaAllah. Do you love Allah more than your father? Yes. Do you love Allah more than your sons? Yes. Do you love Allah more than your wife? More than your husband? More than your husband? You ask any Muslim, and the answer would be the same. We love Allah the most in the world. We love Allah more than our mother, more than our father, more than our sons, more than our wives, more than our husband. The answer is the same. We say it, wallah. But do we actually mean it? I'd like to ask you a simple question again. That suppose, one day in the morning, you leave your house and go to office for work. And when you're away from home, your neighbor, he abuses your mother. He uses foul language against your mother. When you come back home, and when you come to know that your neighbor has abused your mother, verbal abuse, has used foul language against your mother, what will you do? What will you do? What will you do? Banjim, what will you do? Kill him! MashaAllah. One person wants to punch him, one person wants to hit him, one person wants to kill him. See, I do agree, we love our mother. If anyone abuses a mother unnecessarily, without any rhyme or reason, uses foul language against a mother, I do agree, someone would like to hit him, someone would like to punch him, someone would like to kill him. It is human nature. Why? Because we love our mother. How dare someone abuses my mother? And believe me, if you cannot do it yourself, what will you do? You will hire someone else to do the job, but you will teach him a lesson. Yes or no? Yes. Why? Because we love our mother. If someone abuses a mother, he uses foul language against your mother, you will teach him a lesson. Either you'll punch him or you'll hit him. If you cannot do it yourself, you will hire someone else to do the job, but you'll teach him a lesson. Yes or no? Yes, MashaAllah. Why? Because we love our mother. Allah says in the Quran, in Surah Maryam, chapter number 19, verse number 88 to 90, Allah says, وَقَالُوا اتَّقَذُوا الرَّحْمَانُ وَلَدَا. They say that Allah most gracious has begotten a son. لَقَدْ جِيْتُمْ شَيْئًا إِدَّا. Indeed, they have put forth a thing most monstrous. If anyone says that Allah has begotten a son, it is the biggest abuse you can give to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allah is crying in the Quran that if anyone says Allah has begotten a son, it is the most heinous sin you can do. وَقَالُوا اتَّقَذُوا الرَّحْمَانُ وَلَدَا لَقَدْ جِيْتُمْ شَيْئًا إِدَّا تَقَادُ السَّمَاوَاتُ يَتَفَتَّرْنَا مِنُّ. If the sky had feelings, the sky would have burst open. وَتَنْشَقُ الْأَرْضُ. The earth would have split open. وَتَقْرُ الْجِبَالُ حَدَّا. And the mountains would have fallen down to utter ruin. Allah says that if the sky had feelings, and if someone would have said that Allah has begotten a son, the sky would have burst open, the earth would have split open, and the mountains would have fallen to utter ruin. But to us Muslims, believe me, it makes no difference. Every day, our non-Muslim friends, our non-Muslim colleagues, our non-Muslim neighbors, they are abusing Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. They are saying that Allah has begotten a son, and we Muslims, we can't even open our mouth. We say we love Allah more than our mother, more than our father, more than our wife. We say it, but do we mean it every day? You go to school, you go to colleges, you go to universities, you go to place of work, you go to your offices. Every day, our non-Muslim brothers, our Hindu brothers and sisters, our Christian brothers and sisters, they are saying that Allah has begotten a son and we can't even open our mouth. We say we love Allah more than our mothers, more than our fathers. Someone wants to abuse your mother, you want to punch him, you want to hit him, you want to kill him. Every day, our non-Muslim colleagues, our non-Muslim friends, they're abusing Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. They are saying that Allah has begotten a son and we can't even open our mouth. I'm not telling that you should punch him. I'm not telling that you should hit him. I'm not saying that you should fight him. I'm not saying that you should kill him. At least open your mouth. When you say you love Allah more than your mother, more than your father, someone abuses a mother, you want to hire someone else to do the job. When they're abusing our Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, don't fight them, don't hit them. At least open your mouth. Every day. Leave aside opening our mouth. We are afraid to even talk to them. All of us Muslims know very well. When we go for parties, if we go to a party called by a Hindu friend, and if he's having some puja, or gives a prasad. You know, prasad means the food they give to the deity, to the idol. If they offer to the Muslim, almost all the Muslims know that eating prasad is haram. Why? Allah says in no less than four different places. In Surah Baqarah, chapter number 2, verse number 173. In Surah Maidah, chapter number 5, verse number 3. In Surah An'am, chapter number 6, verse number 145. And Surah Nahl, chapter number 16, verse number 115. Hurrimat alaykumul maytutu waddamu walahmul khinzir. Wama uhilla li ghayri Allah bih. Forbidden for you for food, dead meat, blood, the flesh of swine, and any food on which any name besides Allah's name is taken. All of us Muslims know very well that to eat the food on which any name besides Allah's name is taken, it is a sin. But when the Hindus offer you prasad, you feel bad to refuse it. So what do? You say Bismillah and have it. Tomorrow, you'll say Bismillah and have alcohol. Day after tomorrow, you'll say Bismillah and have pork. What's happened to the Muslim Ummah? We can't even open our mouth. I'm not telling fight them. At least open your mouth. Allah says in the Quran in Surah An'am, chapter number 6, verse number 108, revile not those, abuse not those who they worship besides Allah, lest in their ignorance they will abuse Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We cannot abuse, we cannot criticize, we cannot speak bad about those who they worship, those things they worship besides Allah, lest in their ignorance they will abuse Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. I'm not abusing their gods. I'm not insulting, I'm asking a simple question. Who is this God? Simple question, and the work is done. I don't have to do PhD in comparative religion. Simple question, who is this God? And the job is done. But we Muslims, we are afraid. You know, if I do dawah with my non-Muslim, I will lose this friendship. We are more interested in keeping friendship with our friend than keeping friendship with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. What's happened to the Muslim Ummah? And believe me, I speak openly, I keep on traveling. Believe me, my Hindu friends respect me. And if I happen to come on the airport, in the customs, that Hindu customs officer will tell you, Dr. Zakir Naik, jo kahega, sach kahega, sach ke ilawa kuch nahi kahega. Whatever he will say the truth, but nothing but the truth. This is the oath we take in the, when we go in the court of law. When we want to give a witness in the court of law of India, we say in Hindi, I'm sach kahega, sach ke ilawa kuch. So he's telling on my behalf, that whatever Dr. Zakir Naik will say the truth, nothing but the truth. And they let me pass without checking. Hindu, I'm not doing dawa so that they allow me to go, but they respect me more. When I go to the shopkeeper and then Dr. Zakir Naik, good discount, they give me free. We Muslims are afraid that if I do dawa, I lose my business. Here, mashallah, I get better discounts. Simple. I'm not doing it for the discount. Please don't get me wrong. I'm doing it for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And Allah helps me. And imagine now what you saw in the introduction, the person told me that I am coming on the channel And mashallah, millions of non-Muslims in India alone. Throughout the world, there are tens of millions watching our channel, non-Muslim, mashallah. The popularity has increased. Imagine, in a voting of non-Muslims, more than 1 billion people in India, more than 1 billion. The non-Muslims included, they voted me. The only religious preacher in the full list of 100 is a Muslim preacher. There is no Hindu preacher. The only religious preacher, there is no Hindu preacher in the full list of 100. There is no Shankaracharya. There is no Christian priest in the full list of 100. The first time any preacher, any religious preacher that came in the top 100 was a Muslim. In a country in which Muslims are in minority, less than 20%. Why? Because of Dawah. We Muslims, we don't guide the non-Muslims, leave us at that. We become party to them. For example, now within a few months, you will have Christmas coming. Now many of us Muslims, when we meet the Christians, we say, Merry Christmas! Want to increase the friendship. When you are saying Merry Christmas, what are you doing? You are giving Shahada Nauz Billah that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has begotten a son on the 25th of December. Leave aside correcting them. When you say Merry Christmas to your Christian friends, you are giving shahada. You are bearing witness that Nauz Billah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala begot a son on the 25th of December. Leave aside correcting them, you are becoming party to them. It is so easy. If it's Christmas time, only thing you have to ask them, that why do you celebrate Christmas? So they'll tell you it is the birthday of Jesus Christ, peace be upon him. Who is this Jesus Christ, peace be upon him? Oh, Jesus Christ is Almighty God. Immediately, your dawah starts. That there is not a single unequivocal statement in the complete Bible where Jesus Christ, peace be upon himself, says that he is God or where he says, worship me. If any Christian can show me any verse in the Bible, any unequivocal statement, any unambiguous statement in the complete Bible where Jesus Christ, peace be upon him, says that he is God or worship me, I am ready to accept Christianity. Simple. Make it a merry day for them. Where is the question of you agreeing? Many of the Christians, they love me. Many of the Christians, they revere me, they respect me. Many non-Muslims, they tell me that after watching Peace TV, we have come to know more about religion than what we learned in the past 40, 50 years. They respect me, they love me. Why are you afraid? It is the duty that every Muslim should convey the message of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to the non-Muslims. Allah says in the Quran in Surah Baqarah, chapter number 2, verse number 120, وَلَنْ تَرْدَى أَنْكَ الْيَهُدُ وَلَنْ نَصَارَى حَتَّى تَتَبْيُ مِلَّتِهُمْ. The Jews and the Christians, they will never be satisfied until you follow their brand of religion. Allah says in the Quran, the Jews and the Christians, they will never be satisfied with the Muslim until you follow their brand of religion, until you become a Jew or a Christian. Allah says in the Quran in Surah Baqarah, chapter number 2, verse 111. Allah says, وَقَالُوا لَن يَدْخُلَ الْجَنَّةَ إِلَّا مَنْ كَانَ هُودًا أَوْ نَصَارَى. They say, the Jews and Christians, you Muslims, you shall never enter Jannah. With all your piety, with all your tawheed, with all your fasting, with all your salah, with a mark on your forehead, with all the hajj, you shall never enter Jannah unless you become a Jew or a Christian. The Jews and the Christians, they come and tell us, the Muslims, you Muslims, you shall never enter Jannah with all your piety, with all your fasting, with all your hajj, with your salah, with your tawheed, you shall never enter Jannah until you become a Jew or a Christian. Allah says, تِلْكَ أَمَانِيُّهُمْ. This is their wishful thinking. Bakwas, bakwas, vain desires. Kul, tell them, ha tubunanakum, produce your proof in kuntum sadiqeen, but if you're truthful. Tell them to produce the proof if they're truthful. And these Christian missionaries, they have produced the proof. They have produced the Bible in no less than 2,000 different languages. My Bible says this, my Bible says that. My Bible says this, my Bible says that. What do we have to do? Do we have to follow the Bible hook, line and sinker? Whenever someone shows you his proof, suppose someone shows you his identity card, what do? You verify whether it is correct or not. You don't believe in it unless you verify. So if they have shown their proof, their Bible, what do we have to do? We have to verify it. Have we Muslim verified the proof? When Allah says, Qul hatu burhanakum, produce your proof, what does Allah say? Take the proof and believe in it? In kuntum sadiqeen, but if you're truthful. That means Allah is telling us to verify the proof. These Christian missionaries leave aside verifying their proof. What are they doing? They are using our Burhan, our Quran against us. These Christian missionaries, they are using our Quran against the Muslims. There are hundreds of thousands of Christian missionaries throughout the world, millions of them. They come knocking at the doors of the Muslims and they ask the question, you are a Muslim? I said, yes, we are Muslims. It's mentioned in the Quran that Bible is the word of God. And we say, yes, it's mentioned. Then why don't you follow the Bible? We have no reply. That's the next question. That how many times is the name of your Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, mentioned in the Quran? If you know, you'll give the reply that Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam is mentioned by name in the Quran 5 times. 4 as Muhammad, 1 says Ahmad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. That's the next question. How many times is the name of Jesus Christ, peace be upon him, mentioned in the Quran? If you don't know, they will tell you. Jesus Christ, peace be upon him, Isa alayhi salam, is mentioned by name in the Quran 25 times. And if you check up, it is correct. That's the next question. Who is greater? A person who mentioned 5 times by name in the Quran is greater, or a person who mentioned 25 times by name in the Quran is greater? Who's greater? 5 or 25? 5 or 25? 5. 5 is greater than 25. Who is greater? A person who's mentioned 5 times by name in the Quran is greater, or a person who's mentioned 25 times by name in the Quran is greater? They ask the question, but they don't give you the reply. They let your mind think. They poison your mind. They come knocking at the doors of the Muslims. That's the next question. Your Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, did he have a mother and father? You said, yes, he had a mother and father. Did Prophet Jesus, Isa alayhi salam, did he have a mother and father? He said, no. He had a mother, but he had no father. That's the next question. Who is greater? A person who's born with a mother and father is greater, or a person who's born without a father is greater? Who's greater? A person who's born with a mother and father is greater, or a person who's born without a father is greater? Who's greater? Who's greater? Person born? Who's greater? They ask the question, but they don't give the reply. They let your mind think. They use as Muslims as a punching bag. They use us like doormats. And believe me, Muslims can't even answer. That's the next question. Your Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, did he do any miracles? We said, yes, he did many miracles. Did he anytime give life to the dead? And we have to agree that no verse of the Quran, no Sahih Hadith says that Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam gave life to the dead. That's the next question. Did Prophet Jesus, peace be upon him, did he give life to the dead? And we have to agree, the Quran says, Bi-iznillah, wake up in the name of Allah. Yes, he gave life to the dead. So who's greater? A person who can give life to the dead is greater, or a person who cannot give life to the dead is greater? Who's greater? A person who can give life to the dead is greater, or a person who cannot give life to the dead is greater? They ask the question, but they don't give you the reply. They let your mind think. They poison our minds. They ask the next question. Your Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, is he physically dead or alive? He said, no, physically he's dead. He's buried in Medina. Is Isa alayhi salam dead or alive? We have to agree that according to the Quran, Surah Nisa chapter 4, verse 158, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala raised up Isa alayhi salam alive. So who's greater? A prophet who's dead is greater, or a prophet who's alive is greater? Who's greater? A prophet who's dead is greater, or a prophet who's alive is greater? Who's greater? They ask the question, but they don't give you the reply. They let your mind think. They poison your mind. They are using us Muslims like punching bags, like doormats, and we can't even open our mouth. All these replies are given in the Quran. If you read the Quran with understanding, all these replies are there, easy. All the replies are given. You don't have to be a scholar. You have to read the Quran with understanding. All these answers are given. See, doing da'wah is very easy. Allah says in the Quran, in Surah Al-Imran, chapter number 3, verse number 64, كل يا أهل الكتاب. Say, O people of the book. تعالوا إلى كلمة سواء بين بينكم. Come to common terms as between us and you. Which is the first term? Allah na'budu illa Allah. That we worship none but Allah. وَلَا نُشْرِكَ بِهِ شَيْئًا. That we associate to partner with Him. وَلَا يَتَّخِذَ بَعْضُنَا بَعْضًا أَرْبَابًا مِنْ دُونِ اللَّهِ. That we erect not among ourselves lords and patrons other than Allah. فَإِنْ تَوَلَّوْا. If then they turn back. فَقُلُوا شَهَدُوا. Say, I bear witness. بِأَنَّا مُسْلِمُونَ. That we are Muslims bowing our will to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. تَعَالَوْا إِلَىٰ كَلِمَةٍ سَوَاءٍ بَيْنَ بَيْنَكُمْ. Come to common terms as been us and you. Which is the first term? Allah na'budu illa Allah. That we worship none but Allah. The most important point while doing da'wah is come to common terms. And in coming to common terms, the most important of this point is Allah na'budu illa Allah. That we worship none but Allah. You may talk anything about Islam. Oh, Islam is very good. It has got so many benefits, so and so things, everything. Good. About science, technology, fine. But if you do not touch Tawheed, all your da'wah is useless. If you do not stop the shirk that is there in the lifestyle of the non-Muslim, all your da'wah is useless. You can speak about other things than science and technology and Quran and all, fine. To get him to the main point of Tawheed. If you do not touch on Tawheed, Allah na'budu illallah, your da'wah is useless. And I've given the talk on concept of God in the major world religions. And if you read the scriptures of the major world religions, all these major world religions, in the scriptures, it is mentioned about one God. It mentions that God is only one. It mentions He is not begotten. It's mentioned that He has got no idols. He alone should be worshipped. Whether it be Hindu scriptures, whether it be Christian scriptures, Jewish scriptures, Parsi scriptures, all these scriptures mention about one God. But we Muslims, we have many excuses for not doing our job. Many Muslims come and tell me, Brother Zakir, our knowledge is very weak. Inshallah, one day when we get enough knowledge, we start doing da'wah. People want to wait till they want to become like Sheikh Ahmad Didad, and then they start doing da'wah. That time will never come. Our beloved Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, it's mentioned in Sahih Bukhari, volume number 4, hadith number 3461, Balligo anni walau aya. Propagate even if you know one verse about Islam. Even if you know one verse about Islam, our beloved Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, you propagate it. Whatever you know properly, as long as you know it correctly, it's your duty, you have to convey that message to the others. Every Muslim, at least he knows the Shahada. There's no God but Allah and Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon the Messenger of Allah. At least go and tell your non-Muslim friends that there is one Allah, there is one God. If he asks you, what is the proof? If you don't know, you come back and do your homework. In this age of science and technology, everything is on your fingertips. You have got internet, you have got DVDs, video cassettes, audio cassettes, books, literature, and I've given a talk on Is the Quran God's Word, where I've proved scientifically the existence of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. See that DVD? Memorize it, go and give the answer. Now, you are the master of one answer. That there is one God, and you have proved it scientifically. Go and tell him, why don't you believe in last and final messenger? The non-Muslim will tell you, that why should I believe in him? Don't know the answer, come back. I've given the talk, and there's a book also available. Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam in the world religious scriptures. He's mentioned by name, he's prophesied in the Jewish scriptures, Christian scriptures, Hindu scriptures, Parsi scriptures, Buddhist scriptures. Hear it, memorize it, go and give the answer. Now, you are the master of two answers. Continue. Why don't you offer salah? Why I should offer? Come back and do your homework. I've given the talk on Salah, the programming to righteousness. Slowly, slowly, you keep on gaining knowledge. Don't wait till you become like say, at least open your mouth. And the moment you open your mouth, Allah helps you. And the best example is the person standing in front of you. If you know my background, I was a stammerer from childhood. If you would have asked me, maybe 20 years back, what is your name? I said, my name is Zakir. That was me. I could have dreamt of becoming the best doctor or surgeon in the world. In your dreams, you can dream of anything. I could have dreamt of becoming the best surgeon in the world, but I could not have dreamt of speaking in front of 25 people. MashaAllah, inspired by Sheikh Ahmed Didat, Balligwani Walawaya, and I started my Balligwani Walawaya. I haven't gone to Darul Uloom. I haven't gone to an Islamic school. Person from medical background started. But I realized when I started speaking to the Christian missionaries, the priests, the fathers, when I have to speak with them, my stammering used to vanish. When I have to speak with the Muslims, again I have to start stammering. And it went on. I came on the stage by default. It was my friend who got cold feet. I was forced to come. It clicked. And now, by Allah's grace, speaking an audience of tens of thousands of people, hundreds of thousands. Largest audience is 1 million people live. Just on the saying of Sheikh Ahmed Didat, who repeated the saying of a Prophet Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, Balligo anya wala aya. Propagate even one verse. What I heard from Sheikh Didat, one cassette, immediately I started. I didn't wait to see 100 cassettes. Started, and alhamdulillah, the more you repeat, the more Allah gives you. I haven't gone to any Darul Uloom. And imagine now, mashallah, the audiences, live audiences, tens of thousands, hundreds of thousands, 1 million is the largest audience. On the satellite, 100 million people watching, mashallah. We never did this to get fame. We did it for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. It is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala who, mashallah, opens up the pathway. But we Muslims, we have many excuses. You know, many Muslims tell me that when we speak to the non-Muslims, they tell us that first go and improve your Muslims. First go and improve your Muslims. See what they're doing, then come and speak to us. So because the Muslims ourselves are not good, they aren't pious, that's the reason we can't do dawah to the non-Muslims. Today, there are hundreds of thousands of Christian missionaries throughout the world. I ask the question. I ask my Muslim brothers, that do you know these Christian missionaries? You know they have alcohol? Yes, I know. Do you have alcohol? He said, no. Who's better, you or he? I am better. I ask the Muslims. Do these Christians, missionaries, many of them have drugs. Do you have drugs? He said, no. Who's better, he or you? I am better. Now, many of these Christians, they do fornication, they do adultery. Do you do fornication? He said, no. Who's better, him or you? I. With all the defects, these Christian missionaries, with so many defects, yet they're spreading the word of Christianity. Hundreds of them, thousands of them, hundreds and thousands of them. They leave the country and they travel thousands of miles to spread the word of the Bible. Don't give excuse that first go and tell your Muslim brothers. And there are many Muslims who come and tell me, Brother Zakir, first, hum Musalman ko pakka Musalman banayenge, fir hum gair Musalman ko dawa karenge. First, we'll make the Muslims practicing Muslims, and after we make all the Muslims practicing Muslims, then we will go and convey the message to the non-Muslims. I tell them, this time will never come. Our beloved Prophet Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, he himself could not convince his own relatives. Do you think you're better than the Prophet? Our Prophet, he could not convince his own uncle. Do you think you're better than the Prophet? It's mentioned in Sahih Bukhari in the Book of Salah, volume number 1, that the Prophet says that in Medina, there were Muslims who did not come to the mosque for the compulsory Salah. Talking about Jummah Salah. The Prophet says he felt like burning their homes. That means in Medina, there were Muslims who were not good practicing Muslims. Yet the Prophet, he sent messengers, he sent messages to the king of Yemen, to the king of Persia. He sent messages to the king of Byzantine. He did not say, first I'll make all the Muslims 100% practicing Muslims and then I'll convey the message to the non-Muslims. You have to do both simultaneously. When you meet a Muslim, fine, do Islam with him. When you meet a non-Muslim, do Dawah to him. Both are equally important, Dawah and Islam. But if no, which is more important? Both are important. No, which is more important? So I asked him the question. Suppose a patient of heart attack comes to a doctor, stroke. And a patient of common cold comes. And the doctor has limited time. Who should he treat? A person with heart attack or a person with common cold? Who? Heart attack. I'm talking common cold, not swine flu. Huh? Even if swine flu comes, heart attack is more important. Swine flu, it is a media. Media hype, that's another question, we won't deal it now. So the person is a mushrik, he's doing shirk. If you don't convey the message, you will go to hell. The Muslim Islam is important, but more important is da'wah. Actually, both are important. If the doctor has time, you should treat both. The person with heart attack also with common cold. So when you meet a Muslim, do Islah. When you meet a non-Muslim, do Dawah. Both are equally important. Do both. You can't say, I'll first make all the Muslim pakka Musliman and then do Dawah. That time will never come. Our beloved Prophet Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, in the Hajjatul Wida, in the last khutbah he gave, in the last pilgrimage, there were about 110,000 sahabas. He asked them, that did I deliver the message to you? And all of them said, Beshak, they bore witness that yes, you have delivered the message to us. Then the Prophet said, all those who are present here, go and deliver the message to those who are not present here. And do you know, out of this, out of 110,000 sahabas, more than 90,000 sahabas are buried outside Arabia. Doing what? Making Musliman pakka Musliman, making a Muslim more pious Muslim. They were buried outside Arabia doing da'wah to the non-Muslims. More than 80% of the sahabas, they went outside following the commandment of the Prophet, doing da'wah to the non-Muslims. There are many Muslims that have excuses. They say that when we speak to the non-Muslims, they tell me that mind your own business. I tell them, if some non-Muslim tells me that mind your own business, I will tell him, that's what I'm doing. It's my business. It is the business of every Muslim to mind other people's business as far as da'wah is concerned. It's the business of every Muslim to mind other person's business as far as removing shirk is concerned. So that's what I'm doing. So when someone says, mind your own business, that's what I'm doing. This is my business. It's the business of every Muslim to be a da'i. At least a part-time da'i, if not a full-time da'i. I'll give you an example. Suppose if you're going on a hill station along with the family and you have two kids, a girl and a boy, and your boy, Ahmed, 4 years old, while you're talking to your wife, and your small kid, Ahmed, 4 years old, he slips away from you and is going towards the edge of the cliff. Now, by the time you realize that he's missing, he's already gone far away. And then you see him that walking close to the edge of the cliff. You want to shout, Ahmed! Be careful, you'll fall down. But your voice cannot reach him, far away. There you see an elderly gentleman at the edge of the cliff with his hand folded. He's admiring beauty. You want to shout, Mister, Bhai Saab, save my son, he will die. But your voice cannot reach him. This elderly gentleman, he looks at your son, he smiles at your son, then continues admiring beauty. Your son is coming closer to the edge of the cliff. This man again smiles at him and admires beauty. Next step he takes is over the cliff and he falls and he dies. I'm asking the question, will you or will you not blame that elderly gentleman for not saving your son? Will you or will you not? Only thing he had to do was stretch his hand. He didn't even have to take a step forward. Only thing he had to do was stretch his hand and your son would have been saved. Will you blame him or not? Yes or no? Yes. But when you tell him, why didn't you save my son? He will say, I was minding my own business. He's right. He didn't push your son, did he? Did he ask your son to jump? No. Why is he to be blamed? Did he push him? No. Did he ask him to jump? No. But yet you will say, he at least had wisdom. God gave him wisdom. My son, 4 years old, masoom, innocent. What does he know? Yet you will blame him. Will you or will you not? Of course. Same way, on the day of judgment, these mushriks, these non-Muslims, on the day of judgment, they will blame the Muslims. They will catch your collar. that when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, when Almighty God gave you hidayah, why didn't you tell us? On the day of judgment, these non-Muslims will blame the Muslims and tell that why didn't these Muslims who Allah gave hidayah to, who Allah gave guidance to, why didn't they correct us? It is the duty of every Muslim that he conveys the message of Islam to the non-Muslims. Suppose if you have a neighbor who's a mushrik, and if you have not conveyed the message of Islam to him, and if he dies, Allah will ask him on the day of judgment, why didn't you accept Islam? He will say, Ya Allah, Bari Ta'ala, no one gave me the message. He said, I gave the message directly to you. You did shirk, you'll go to hell. Allah will ask you next, did you convey the message to your neighbor, non-Muslim neighbor? And if you say no, you will follow him. You will follow him. It's the duty of every Muslim that he should convey the message of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to those who are not aware of it. But we Muslims, we have many excuses. We have many excuses for not doing the job. Many of the Muslims tell me, you know, but Allah says in the Quran, Lakum deenukum waliyaddeen. The Quran says, Lakum deenukum waliyaddeen. No, to you is your way, to me is mine. So why should we do dawah? What they're quoting is a verse of the Quran from Surah Kafirun, chapter 109, verse number 6. What they're quoting is the last verse of Surah Kafirun. It is out of context. If you really want to quote Surah Kafirun, quote in context from verse number 1. Surah Kafirun, chapter 109, verse number 1 to 6. Qul ya ayyuhal kafirun, la abdu ma ta'budun, wala antum abduna ma'bud, wala ana abdu ma'budtum, wala antum abduna ma'bud, lakum deenukum aliyaddeen. Say to those who reject faith, I will not worship that which you worship, nor will you worship what I worship. I will not worship what you want me to worship, nor will you worship what I worship. To use your way, to me is mine. After you have delivered the message of Islam, and then if he does not accept it, then you can say that I will not worship what you worship, you will not worship what I worship. To use your way, to me is mine. Unless you have not delivered the message of Islam to the non-Muslim, you cannot say lakum deenukum waliyaddeen. Muslims tell me, but doesn't Allah say la ikraha fiddeen, there's no compulsion in religion? Again, out of context. What the quoting is the words of Quran from Surah Baqarah, chapter number 2, verse number 256. It does say la ikraha fiddeen, there's no compulsion in religion, but it continues. But truth stands out clear from error. And if you reject the evil one and believe in Allah, you have grasped the most strongest handhold, which will never break. When you say la ikraha fiddeen, there's no compulsion in religion, you also have to say truth stands out clear from error. You convey the truth to them. You can't force anyone to accept Islam. You can't force anyone to accept the Quran or accept Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. You can't put a gun on his forehead. You can't take a sword. It's not allowed. But at least you convey the message. You can't force agree, but at least convey. Tell them truth stands out clear from error. So unless you have not conveyed the message, you cannot say lakum deenukum waliyaddeen. After conveying the message, you can say la ikraha fiddeen, there is no compulsion in religion. You can't force anyone, but at least convey the message. It's the duty of every Muslim to at least be a part-time dai. It's a fard. It's the duty of every Muslim to at least be a part-time dai. Dawah is a fard for every Muslim. Allah says in the Quran, in Surah Al-Asr, chapter number 103, verse number 1 to 3, Wal Asr, Innal insana lafi khusr, illa ladhina amanu wa amilu salihati wa tawasaw bil haqq wa tawasaw bis sabr. That by the token of time, Allah is taking the promise that human beings are in khasara, they are in loss, except those who have faith, those who have righteous deeds, those who exhort people to truth, and those who exhort people to patience and perseverance. For any human being to go to Jannah, minimum four criteria are required: iman, righteous deeds, exhorting people to truth, that is doing dawah, and exhorting people to patience and perseverance. If any one of these four criteria is missing, you shall not enter Jannah. You may be a very good Muslim, you may be offering five times salah, you may be fasting in the month of Ramadan, you may perform Hajj, but if you don't do dawah, you shall not enter Jannah according to Surah Al-Asr. If Allah wants to forgive you, and put you in Jannah, it is Allah's prerogative. Allah says in the Quran in Surah Nisa chapter 4 verse 48 and Surah Nisa chapter 4 verse 116 that if Allah pleases, He may forgive any sin, but the sin of shirk He'll not forgive. Because a person who commits shirk has strayed away far. So if Allah wants to forgive you and put you in Jannah, it is Allah's prerogative. But under normal circumstances, according to Surah Al-Asr, if you don't do dawah, you shall not enter Jannah. Only dawah is also not sufficient. All four are equally important. Iman, righteous deed, watawasaw bil haq, that is dawah and islah, watawasaw bil sabr, inviting people to patience and perseverance. So it's compulsory that every Muslim should at least be a part-time dai. You don't have to be a full-time dai like Shaykh Didat, or a full-time dai like me. At least be a part-time dai, it's a fard. Allah also says in the Quran, in Surah Al-Imran, chapter number 3, verse number 104, one of the verses which the Qari, Farik, he recited, which says, Allah says in Surah Al-Imran, chapter 3, verse 104, that let there arise out of you a band of people who are inviting towards good, enjoining what is right, and forbidding what is wrong. Allah is talking about full-time dais. How you have full-time doctors, full-time engineers, full-time lawyers, full-time businessmen. How many full-time dais do you have? How many dais do you have which travel to different parts of the world and convey the message? You can count them on your fingertips. Allah says in the Quran that let there arise out of you a band of people, dais, who are inviting people to the good, enjoining what is right and forbidding what is wrong. These are the ones that shall attain felicity. I mean, these are the ones that will attain a higher grade in Jannah, Allah says. Here Allah is talking full-time dais. There is no better profession than a profession of a dai. Allah says in the Quran in Surah Nahl, chapter number 16, verse number 125, Udu ila sabili rabbika bil hikmah wal mu'azid al hasna wajadun billati hasan, that invite all to the way of thy Lord with wisdom and beautiful preaching, and argue with them and reason with them in the ways that are best and most gracious. I would like to end this talk by giving the message which is repeated in the Quran in no less than 3 different places. Allah says in the Quran, in Surah Tawbah, chapter number 9, verse number 33, in Surah Saf, chapter number 61, verse number 9, and Surah Fatah, chapter 48, verse number 28, Allah says, هُوَ الَّذِي أَرْسَلَ رَسُولَهُ بِالْهُدَى وَالدِّينِ الْحَقِّ لِيُذْهِرَهُ عَلَى الدِّينِ كُلِّهِ وَلَوْ قَرِهَ الْمُشْرِكُونَ, that Allah has sent His messenger with guidance and the religion of truth so that it will prevail over all the other religions, all the other isms, whether it be Christianism, Judaism, Hinduism, Buddhism, Jainism, Atheism, Secularism, Modernism. Islam is destined to supersede all, kulli, master them all. However much the mushrik don't like it, however much the idol worshippers don't like it. Allah mentioned this twice in Surah Tawbah chapter 9 verse 33 and Surah Saf chapter 16 verse number 9. And the third time in Surah Fatah chapter 48 verse number 28, Allah repeats the message a different ending. Allah says, هُوَ الَّذِي أَرْسَلَ رَسُولَهُ بِالْهُدَى وَالدِّينِ الْحَقِّ لِيُذْهِرَهُ عَلَى الدِّينِ كُلِّهِ وَقَفَى بِاللَّهِ شَهِيدًا, that Allah sent His messenger with guidance. He has sent the last and final messenger, Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, with guidance and the religion of truth, so that it will prevail over all the other religions, over all the other isms, whether it be Christianism, Judaism, Hinduism, Buddhism, Jainism, Parsiism, Sikhism, Atheism, Modernism, Secularism. Islam is destined to supersede all, kulli, master them all. وَقَفَى بِاللَّهِ شَهِيدًا, and enough is Allah as a witness. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala does not require you and me the rubbish that we are. Allah does not require you and me to make His deen prevail. If we think that if we don't do dawah, Islam would not spread. If I start thinking that if I don't do dawah, Islam would not spread, I'm the biggest fool in the world. Allah does not require you and me to make His deen prevail, the rubbish that we are. Allah doesn't require you and me. Allah is sufficient to make His deen prevail. Allah is giving us an opportunity to make hay while the sun is shining. Allah has promised His deen will prevail. whether you and I do da'wah or not, Islam is bound to prevail. Allah is giving you an opportunity to do a prophet's job and to earn a prophet's reward. I like to end the talk with the quotation of the glorious Quran from Surah Fusilat, chapter number 41, verse number 33, which changed me from a doctor of a body to a doctor of soul. When I became a medical doctor because I thought it was the best profession in the world. It is a good profession. But when I found a better profession, the profession of a dai, I changed my profession from a doctor of a body to a doctor of soul. I will end the talk with the verse of the Quran of Surah Fusilat, chapter number 41, verse number 33, where Allah says that وَمَنْ أَحْسَنُ قَالَ مِمَّنْ دَعَى إِلَى اللَّهِ وَعَمِلَ صَالِحًا قَالَ إِنِّي مِنَ الْمُسْلِمِينَ. That who is better in speech than one who invites people to the way of their Lord, works righteousness and says that I am a Muslim. وَآخِرُ دَعْوَانَ الْحَمْدُ لِلَّهِ رَبِّ الْعَالَمِينَ.